So welcome to the joint Columbia-CUNY-NYU Number Theory Seminar. Our speaker today is Ben Howard from Boston College, talking about arithmetic volumes of unitary Shimura varieties.
Okay, thank you for the introduction and the opportunity to speak. Before I jump in with the unitary Shimura variety, before I even say that, everything I'm going to talk about is joint work with Jan Brunier. Before I start talking about unitary Shimura varieties, let's orient ourselves by starting with the first basic case of arithmetic volumes, which is for modular curves. So Y is going to be the moduli space of elliptic curves. Over all schemes, the integral model over spec Z. If you like, you can just think of this as the coarse moduli space, but really you should think of it as the Deline-Mumford stack, but the stackiness is not gonna play a huge role. And then that has the usual Deline-Rappaport compactification. Because there's no level structure, they're just bare elliptic curves. In the complex fiber, we're just adjoining the one cusp to compactify. Okay. Over the moduli space, you of course have the universal object. There's a universal elliptic curve. And that elliptic curve determines a line bundle on the modular curve. An elliptic curve has a Lie algebra. It's just a one-dimensional vector space. You construct it point by point on the modular curve, and you get a family of lines. You get a line bundle. We're going to take the inverse of that. So the inverse of the Lie algebra of the universal elliptic curve, we're going to call the line bundle of modular forms of weight one, because you can in fact identify sections of that over the open modular curve with holomorphic functions that transform like modular forms of weight minus one. And that line bundle has a natural metric on it, which depending on the context is either the Hodge, Faltings, or Peterson metric, which depends on giving a different and slightly different interpretation of the line bundle. Namely, you start with the sheaf of Kähler differentials on the elliptic curve, and you just push it forward to get a line bundle on the base. Okay. And now, what is the metric? Well, if I give you the complex point of the modular curve corresponding to some elliptic curve over the complex numbers, and a vector in the fiber of that line bundle at the point, well, what does it mean to give a vector in the fiber of this line bundle? It's just a global holomorphic one form on the corresponding elliptic curve. And you can take that global holomorphic one form, wedge it against its complex conjugate to get a differential form of type 1,1, and then integrate it. And then you throw in a 1/2 pi i just sort of for fun and take the absolute value. And that's the definition of the metric. Okay. And so we now have a distinguished metrized line bundle.
The Faltings height?
The Faltings height is an invariant you attach to an elliptic curve. And here we're attaching a number to a vector in a fiber. You can use it to compute the Faltings height. If you choose this section, this SY is a vector in a complex vector space, okay? If your Y is say a point over Q, then you get a Q vector space. And then this would compute the Faltings height of the elliptic curve EY up to some Q linear combinations of logs of prime numbers. So it's the Faltings height up to some little errors, and to get rid of the errors and get the exact Faltings height, you have to really normalize this vector in an appropriate way. So if Y is a rational point and you choose this particular vector very carefully, you will get the Faltings height of the elliptic curve. Make sense?
Sounds good.
Okay, great. So it's right. It's the metric and line bundle that compute the Faltings height, better way to say it. Okay, we can extend this line bundle to the compactified modular curve in a natural way. Namely, the theory of Deline-Rappaport tells you that the universal elliptic curve, well, you can't extend it as an elliptic curve to the compactification, but you can extend it as a smooth group scheme in such a way that the fiber at the cusp is just the multiplicative group GM. So the elliptic universal elliptic curve degenerates to a torus. But that's fine. A torus still has a Lie algebra. And so we can still extend our line bundle to the compactification by taking the inverse Lie algebra of this group scheme. But then you hit an annoying problem, which is that the metric itself, the metric does not extend across the cusp. It has some singularity, which basically means like, let's say if S is a section of this line bundle over the complex numbers, so non-vanishing at Q equals zero, where Q equals zero is the you know, local equation for the cusp, then minus, let's just say the norm of S squared is gonna look like minus the log of the absolute value of Q squared, plus something smooth, something that extends smoothly. Okay, so this is telling you that the metric has this sort of logarithmic singularity at the cusp. And there's a, so the section, the metric itself has this sort of mild singularity. If you take various derivatives of this, you can also give bounds on their singularities. And so when you bound this and del of this and del bar of this and del bar of this, and they all have certain growth conditions, that's what Borgos, Kramer, and Kuhn would call pre-log singularities. And Borgos, Kramer, and Kuhn have, they've extended arithmetic intersection theory to allow for things like metrized line bundles with these kind of log singularities. And so our metrized line bundle, we could talk about the space of metrized line bundles on the compactification, but this is something slightly enlarged. So this is going to be line bundles on the compactification together with a metric on the open modular curve, which has these very kind of mild singularities at the cusp. So that's what I mean when I write pick out of Y bar. The Borgos, Kramer, Kuhn arithmetic Picard group. In particular, so like any metrized line bundle, it has a churn form. So some 1-1 form on the interior of the modular curve. And these mild singularities at the cusp imply that the churn form is integrable. And so you can ask, what's the integral of the churn form? And the answer is, 1 over 24, which you could rewrite if you like as minus 1/2 the zeta function at minus 1. And this equality, this is almost an exercise in pure thought. So think about it for a second. So ignore the business about singularity at the cusp. If you have a metrized line bundle and you take its churn form and you integrate it, you recover the degree of the line bundle. So what I'm really claiming is that the degree of the line bundle of weight one modular forms is 1/24. So it's a fraction because of stacky issues, and you have to interpret this integral in some orbifold sense. But here's why you get 1/24. Imagine taking the 12th power of the line bundle of weight one modular forms. It has a distinguished global section, which is Ramanujan's discriminant. Ramanujan's discriminant has a simple zero at the cusp, which says that the line bundle of weight 12 modular forms should have degree one. So the line bundle of weight one modular forms should have degree 1/12. And we're off by a factor of two just because of purely stacky reasons. There's a correction because the extra two comes in because that's the number of automorphisms of a typical elliptic curve. So there's a correction for stacky issues. And that's where you get 1/24 from. Okay. Now, arithmetic intersection theory. Okay, so the theory is first due to Gillet and Soule, and then it was extended by Borgos, Kramer, and Kuhn to allow for certain, like I said, these mild pre-log singularities. What their theory gives you is the following. The space of metrized line bundles maps to the arithmetic Chow group of codimension one arithmetic cycles. So that classifies a divisor together with a choice of green function meaning to some function with logarithmic singularities along the divisor, modulo some notion of rational equivalence. And that arithmetic turn class map, it just takes a metrized line bundle. You choose any rational section of it, and you get the, you take the divisor of the section for the underlying geometric part of the arithmetic divisor. And then as a green function for it, well, you want something with logarithmic singularities along the divisor. So you take minus the log of the norm of the section squared. Okay. The most interesting part of their theory is that it gives you arithmetic intersections. There's an intersection pairing from in any complementary codimensions. Since our Y bar is a two-dimensional thing, the only interesting thing is the pairing from chow hat one into chow hat two. And then chow hat two is classifying arithmetic zero cycles, and whatever an arithmetic zero cycle is, there's some notion of arithmetic degree. So an arithmetic zero cycle is just going to be a zero cycle on Y bar, together with some choice of smooth 1-1 form in the complex fiber. And so the degree is you count up the points in your zero cycle, but then you add in the integral of that 1-1 form in the complex fiber. And so once you've got all this machinery, you can take any metrized line bundle and define its arithmetic volume just by you apply the arithmetic Chern class map to get into chow hat one. You can then compute its self-intersection, and then you can compute the arithmetic degree. And it attaches a number to any metrized line bundle. In particular, it attaches one to our metrized line bundle of weight one modular forms. So what is this number? Okay, it was computed independently by Boston-Kuhn around 2000. And here it is. So there's a minus 1/2. The interesting thing here, so there's the integral of the Chern form, which I already said was 1/24. But the interesting part is the logarithmic of derivative of the Riemann zeta function at minus one. Okay. So this is a very beautiful formula. And I mean, just to give you some sense of what goes into the proof. So like I already said, if you take this line bundle of weight one modular forms and take its 12th power, okay, it has this distinguished section, which at least over the open modular curve has no zeros or poles anywhere, even on the integral model. In other words, on the open modular curve, Ramanujan's discriminant trivializes the line bundle of weight 12 modular forms. But when you trivialize it using Ramanujan's discriminant, you get the trivial bundle, but endowed with an interesting metric on it. The metric is basically like minus the log of the absolute value of the discriminant. But the point is all of the interesting information is really pushed into the complex fiber. And so in this calculation of this volume, the integral model is kind of an illusion. All of the arithmetic intersection theory is kind of an illusion. It's really just something happening purely in the complex fiber. And it's really some question about Ramanujan's discriminant. And when Boston-Kuhn, well, Boston's proof was never published. So I actually can only tell you what Kuhn's proof looks like. It's just a problem with classical modular forms that eventually boils down to the Kronecker limit formula. So that's what goes into this. Now, the question makes sense. It's the same sort of question you can ask on most Shimura varieties, anything of PEL type, just meaning it has a moduli interpretation, or something of Hodge type, which just means you can embed it into something that has a moduli interpretation. Because in either one of those cases, your Shimura variety is going to come with some sort of distinguished abelian variety that lives over it. And you can attach to it a metrized line bundle. You take the Lie algebra, you get some vector bundle, you dualize it, and you take its top exterior power. And that gives you a line bundle on the Shimura variety. And you can define a metric on it by integrating differential forms in exactly the same way that we did on modular curves. And then you can ask, well, what's the arithmetic volume of that? So this seems to be extremely difficult in general. One reason it's difficult is that the method used for modular curves breaks down completely because there's no obvious analog of Ramanujan's discriminant on an arbitrary Shimura variety. It's something really special about modular curves. But there's been a lot of work. So Kudler, Rappaport, and Yang did the case of quaternionic Shimura curves, which already requires very different methods from what Boston-Kuhn did. Brunier, Borgos, and Kuhn did Hilbert modular surfaces. Jung and von Pippich did the Ziegle threefold. And okay, once you have these kinds of low dimensional cases, you start to think, well, I mean, maybe this problem is approachable in general. And then you realize that, in fact, all of these low dimensional examples have something in common. Quaternionic Shimura curves are secretly orthogonal Shimura varieties for an orthogonal group of signature 1-2. Hilbert modular surfaces are actually orthogonal Shimura varieties in signature 2-2, and the Ziegle threefold is actually an orthogonal Shimura variety in signature 3-2. And the fact that these cases are accessible seems to be very closely tied up with the fact that they lie in this orthogonal family. And in fact, Fritz Hermann did the general case of orthogonal Shimura varieties. So while the question makes sense on most Shimura varieties, it seems to be very difficult to get past the orthogonal case. But we can try. So unitary Shimura varieties of signature n minus 1 comma 1. Okay, so start with a quadratic imaginary field K. Let D be minus its discriminant. Assume that it's odd. And for any n, at least 2, we can form a certain moduli space of abelian varieties. So M sub n minus 1, 1 is going to be the moduli space of n-dimensional abelian varieties over C, together with an action of the ring of integers in our quadratic imaginary field, satisfying the signature n minus 1, 1 condition. The signature n minus 1, 1 condition is that you can choose a basis of the Lie algebra in such a way that any x in OK acts as mostly just by a scalar, x, 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 x along the diagonal, and then one lonely complex conjugate of x at the end. That's the signature n minus 1, 1. And then we include a principal polarization that's compatible with the OK action in some way that's not terribly important to us. Okay. Now this this signature condition that I've imposed here is equivalent to saying that inside the Lie algebra, you can find a hyperplane on which OK acts through one embedding of OK into the complex numbers, and it acts through the conjugate embedding on the quotient. Okay. So this hyperplane is going to come up momentarily. Because when you want to extend this and construct an integral model of this sort of thing, you have to worry about exactly how you phrase the signature condition. So this is known how to do this. So Pappas and Nicole Kramer have constructed a flat regular integral model of this of dimension n. And you can construct a canonical toroidal compactification of that as well. So that's as long as you stay away from the primes of bad reduction, the primes dividing the discriminant D, that's in Kaiwen Land's thesis. And you have to do a little more work at the bad primes. Okay, and the moduli interpretation is you mostly copy it from the complex numbers. It parameterizes an abelian scheme of dimension n together with an OK action, a principal polarization, and now you phrase the signature condition as a choice of hyperplane such that OK acts on the hyperplane in one way, but acts on the quotient in a different way. Okay, so we have this nice regular integral model. And let me point out, there are actually, on this integral model, there are two interesting line bundles. One is the one we were talking about before, where you take the Lie algebra, dualize, and then take the top exterior power. But also, because our moduli problem includes a choice of hyperplane in the Lie algebra, you can just take the Lie algebra of the universal abelian variety and then mod out by the distinguished hyperplane. So we've got these two line bundles floating around. Okay, this moduli space is not quite literally a Shimura variety, but it's almost a Shimura variety. So it decomposes into a bunch of pieces that are indexed by K Hermitian spaces of signature n minus 1, 1 that admit a self-dual lattice. So there are only finitely many such things up to isometry. And you take the modulo some notion of similarity, which is not, I mean, the actual definition is not too important. I'll just point out that if n is even, similar just means isometric. And if n is odd, all of the v's are similar. So there's actually no decomposition at all in the odd case. And then once we fix a v, it's got a universal abelian variety over it. We can restrict it, form this line bundle, this analog of the line bundle of weight one modulo five. Okay, and try to compute its arithmetic volume. So here's the theorem. This is a little, I wrote it a little small because I wanted everything on one slide. Okay, our choice of quadratic imaginary field gives us a quadratic Dirichlet character, just given by the Legendre symbol. The arithmetic volume is going to be expressed in terms of logarithmic derivatives of certain L functions. So here are the L functions that are going to appear. So for k between 1 and n, the interesting part here is, well, if k is even, it's the Riemann zeta function. And if k is odd, it's the Dirichlet L function associated to our quadratic character. We're shifting the variable a little bit, putting in the usual gamma factors, and then correcting the Euler factors at the bad primes, the primes dividing the discriminant. And the correction factors are what remember which Hermitian space we're working with. So any Hermitian space has a local invariance at any prime, just defined by taking the determinant of the Hermitian form and taking its Hilbert symbol against minus the discriminant of the quadratic imaginary field. So we have these modified Euler factors here. Okay, and so here's the theorem. If you integrate the churn form of this metrized line bundle, take its top exterior power, you get a product of L values. So the beta one at zero, dot, 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 beta n at zero, times some little minor correction, depending on whether n is even or odd. So what is this product? I mean, it's a product of L values where we alternate between the Riemann zeta function and this Dirichlet L function. And we're looking at their values at k equals 1, 2, 3, up to n. And those are all positive rational numbers here. So this is not really, part one, the intro of the churn form, is not really new. So things like this were computed by Ziegel. I'm not sure in what generality he did them. I'm not sure if he did these particular Shimura varieties. I'm including it because the integral of the churn form shows up in part two, but also this is just going to fall out of the calculation of the arithmetic volume, which is the thing we really want to get at. Okay, and so what is the arithmetic volume? Well, it's mostly just the sum of the logarithmic derivatives at zero of all of these L functions, betas that I've defined, and then some small correction factors. There's a log d, and then there's some funny constant, which is more copies of the logarithmic derivative of the Dirichlet L function at zero, which this shows up because, like I said, we really have two line bundles floating around. We're gonna compute the volume of both of them. If we computed the volume of the other one, we'd get the same formula, but without this correction factor, which suggests that maybe the other one is the more natural thing to look at in the first place. But this is the theorem. And I'm going to spend the bulk of the rest of the talk trying to explain how to prove this, okay? Questions about the statement?
So as you mentioned, Ziegel certainly considered the geometric case for the Ziegel space, the Ziegel modular variety.
So he certainly did the Ziegel case.
Yeah, so is the conjecture the same shape for the arithmetic volume for Ziegel spaces?
I'm not sure there is a conjecture. There's a paper of Rossler and Mayer, French name that I can't pronounce, where they have certain conjectural values for periods that include things like this. I haven't looked at their paper closely enough to know if it actually includes this particular one or in what generality it is.
But is it?
Sure there is a general conjecture.
Yeah, but is it related to log derivative L functions? Because the geometric term are just the values of zeta functions, right? Product right. of zeta function. It's exactly the same shape as in one.
Yes.
So is the shape the same as two, or it's something completely different?
You mean in the Ziegel case?
In the Ziegel case.
So certainly the arithmetic volume in the Ziegel case is not known in general.
Yeah.
For the threefold. Yeah. I'm not sure there is a conjectural formula.
Oh, okay, okay. So the naive conjecture may be false. Okay.
Okay, now I understand what you mean. If the if the first one is known, then there is automatically a naive conjecture for the second one.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, the proof is by induction on the dimension of the Shimura variety, or equivalently the dimension on the induction on the dimension of the Hermitian space. So the induction starts at n equals 2, when the complex fiber of the Shimura variety is just a curve. So we're in signature 1-1, and the curves that you get are essentially just modular curves and unitary, modular curves and quaternionic Shimura curves, because SU11 is actually just SL2R. So you can relate MV to either a modular curve or a quaternionic Shimura curve. There's something to do. I mean, you have to explicitly relate the moduli interpretations of these things to get maps on the level of integral models, which is a little bit subtle. But I mean, given this isomorphism, certainly plausible that one can do it. And once you've related this unitary Shimura variety to a modular curve or a quaternionic Shimura curve, you can invoke the known calculations of Boston-Kuhn in the modular curve case and Kudla-Rapoport-Yang in the quaternionic Shimura curve case. So the base case is just we deduce it from the known cases before. And that's all I'm going to say about the base case. Okay, now here's kind of a subtlety, which is I said that it was very hard to get past the orthogonal family. So the reason we can do these particular unitary groups is because they are so closely related to orthogonal groups. So we're going to replace the unitary Shimura variety by a finite Attal cover by just crossing it with the moduli space of all elliptic curves with complex multiplication by OK. So in the complex fiber, this is just a finite set of points, and we're just taking a product of disjoint union of copies of MV with itself. But there's a very particular reason for doing this, namely this funny finite Attal cover you can realize as a Shimura variety for a different group, namely a set of pairs alpha G where alpha is in K cross and G is in the unitary similitude group of our Hermitian space. And this slightly different group actually maps to the honest unitary group. You can kill the similitude character by using the second factor alpha, send alpha G to alpha inverse G. And once you have an honest unitary group, that's always sitting inside of an orthogonal group in a natural way, because every Hermitian space has a quadratic form on it. Q of V is the Hermitian form of V with itself. So once we replace our Shimura variety by this sort of very mild finite Attal cover, we can actually map MV to an orthogonal Shimura variety and then try to use some of the machinery that was used to compute arithmetic volumes in the orthogonal Shimura variety case, especially the theory of Borchardt's products, which really come from orthogonal Shimura varieties. Okay, now over this cover, where we're now working with pairs, it parameterizes pairs consisting of a CM elliptic curve and the abelian variety. Uh-oh, I think my pencil might have run out of battery. Oh, there it is, okay, good. Okay, so over this cover, there's this universal pair consisting of an elliptic curve and a higher dimensional abelian variety. And so on the cover, you can define a new line bundle. So remember the moduli problem defining MV gave us inside the Lie algebra of the universal object, this distinguished hyperplane. And so on this product, on this M0 across MV, we can take that and tensor it with the Lie algebra of the universal CM elliptic curve. And then this has some natural metric on it. And this looks like a funny thing to do, but it's natural in the sense that having replaced MV by this cover, we now map MV into an orthogonal Shimura variety. And this funny twist happens to be a pullback from the orthogonal Shimura variety. And it takes some work to prove this, but this new line bundle is not essentially different from the one that we had before. So the top exterior power of the dual Lie algebra of A, you have to do some work to relate them. They're isomorphic up to some vertical divisors, some divisors supported in at the bad primes, shifting the metric. And if that's all you had to do, it wouldn't be so hard to prove that they were isomorphic, but they're never actually going to be isomorphic, because in Chow Hat 1, you also, they're only going to be equal up to numerical equivalence, where numerical equivalence means if you take any element of the arithmetic Chow group of complementary dimension and intersect it with these things, it'll give you the same number. So from the point of view of arithmetic intersection theory, these are indistinguishable. So now we take the one that we wanted to compute and replace it by this other one. Okay. The reason we replace it by this other line bundle, which is pulled back from the orthogonal Shimura variety, is because this other line bundle is where Borchard's products live. So what are Borchard's products? Okay. The input to this, Borchard's products are going to be certain rational sections of our line bundle. The input to the construction is going to be a weakly holomorphic form of weight n minus 2. So it's just a modular form on the upper half plane for the congruent subgroup gamma 0 d, except I'm going to allow it to have poles at the cusps, but only at the cusp infinity. So that's what this shriek infinity means. It can have a pole at one cusp, but no others. So in particular, its Q expansion is allowed to have negative powers of Q in it. And given any such form, Borchard's constructs a rational section of a certain power of this line bundle omega V. And the power is the constant term of the weakly modular form. Okay. And the most important property of these Borchard's products is that we know explicitly what their divisors are. The divisor of the Borchard's product determined by F, you can read it off from the coefficients of the negative powers of Q. You can read it off from the polar part of F. So you take those negative coefficients and you make them the linear, you make those the coefficients in some linear combination where the divisors are Kudla-Rapoport divisors on the unitary Shimura variety, which are defined on the next slide, but you don't need to know the exact definition. All you need to know is that whatever these Kudla-Rapoport divisors are, the important thing is that they are essentially more unitary Shimura varieties constructed in the same way as MV, just in one dimension lower, associated to a Hermitian space of one dimension lower. So we're taking smaller unitary groups, embedding them into larger unitary groups, and these give us divisors. And like in every other computation that I talk about after this, every equality is up to some slightly horrific linear combination of things going wrong at the bad primes that I'm gonna omit. I mean, there's some error term at the bad primes. The error is explicit. It was computed in a paper I wrote with Brunier, Kudla, Rapoport, and Yang. Okay, here's the definition of the Kudla Rapoport divisor. Don't read the slide. They're just smaller unitary groups. It's all you need to know. In fact, I mean, now I'm going to tell you what they are in a particular case. So morally, they're just Shimura varieties associated with smaller unitary groups. Let's take, instead of Z of M, let's take the Kudla-Rapoport divisor indexed by a prime congruent to 1 mod D. Okay? In that case, I can tell you exactly what it is. It is up to the scare quotes, P to the N minus 1 plus 1 times MV prime, where what is V prime? It's a Hermitian space of one lower dimension. I said that every Hermitian space has this family of local invariants. You take the Hermitian space of one lower dimension. So we went from signature, so V had signature, signature of V was N minus 1, 1. So we drop the signature down by one. So we're one dimension lower, but you keep all the same local invariants. That determines a Shimura variety in one dimension lower. This Z of P is essentially P to the N minus 1 plus 1 copies of that Shimura variety, and essentially means, so I'll just say it. You take this Z of P, it's some divisor. You decompose it into its irreducible components. You can realize every irreducible component as a finite atal cover of this MV prime. And when you add up the degrees of all of those covers, you get this. Mm. So basically it's P to the N minus 1 plus 1 copies of this thing. up to, I mean, this is an equality of divisors, up to all the error terms, which are a bunch of components at primes dividing P and the discriminant of the quadratic imaginary field, which one has to compute and keep track of. But you can do it. And when you identify the divisor Z of P with a bunch of copies of MV prime, MV prime has its own Hermitian line bundle on it, just like the one on MV. And if you take the line bundle on MV, restrict it back to the Kudla-Rapoport divisor, and then restrict it back to one copy of MV prime sitting in here, you recover the same Hermitian line bundle that lived natively on MV prime. Okay. All right, so how are we gonna use this? So when we go back, we're gonna choose a nice form F here for as the input to Borchardt's construction. The choice of forms that we have in this space, this is an infinite dimensional space. So we have a huge amount of freedom for how we choose this form F. Okay? So we're gonna choose one that suits our purposes. Namely, for simplicity, suppose we choose this form F in such a way that the only negative power of Q in its Q expansion is a prime congruent to one mod D, and the coefficient is one. And that's the only negative power of Q that we get. You probably can't do this, but you can always choose it so that the polar part only involves those kinds of exponents, only Q to the minus P, where P is a prime congruent to one mod D. And so, but let's just pretend you can choose it slightly nicer, just because it'll make everything a lot simpler. So then I said that the divisor of the Borchardt's product was given by some linear combination of these Kudla-Rapoport divisors, where the coefficients of the Kudla-Rapoport divisors you read off from the polar part of the modular form, which we've now assumed is extremely simple. And so that formula says that the divisor of the Borchardt's product is now just this one Kudla-Rapoport divisor. That's simple enough that we know that it's basically just a unitary Shimura variety in one dimension lower. Great. Okay. We're trying to compute arithmetic volumes and integrals of churn forms, and at some point, there's supposed to be L functions appearing.
Yeah.
So we're gonna sneak the L function in. Okay, watch this, this is tricky. The weight of the Borchardt's product is the constant term of this weakly holomorphic form F, right? Mm-hmm. And we've assumed that F has a particularly simple form. Mm-hmm. Now I claim that the constant term, which is the weight of the Borchardt's product, is actually determined by the polar part.
Yeah.
Okay? And in this case, that's for our particularly simple polar part, that's giving us an explicit formula for the constant term, which involves this L function beta n, which was really just the Dirichlet L function shifted by n. Why is that the constant term? Okay, because I can take my weakly holomorphic form and I can multiply it by a certain Eisenstein series of weight n, which vanishes at every cusp other than the cusp at infinity. And when I multiply my form F, which had weight 2 minus n, by this Eisenstein series, which has a weight n, and put a d tau on it, I get a holomorphic one form on the upper half plane with a pole at infinity and nowhere else. And so by the residue formula, the residue at infinity has to be zero. But you can read off the residue from the Q expansions, and all you do is you take the product, sum over m greater than or equal to zero, of the coefficient of q to the minus m in the form times the coefficient of q to the m in the Eisenstein series. And because the only c of minus m's that appear in our form f are for m equals zero and m equals p, and the coefficient of minus q is one, we only get two terms in this sum. And so the constant term has to be given by this Eisenstein series coefficient. And you can just open up Miyake's book on modular forms and look up what these coefficients are. And for a prime congruent to one mod D, you get this. It's an L value. And now I can prove the formula for the integral return form. This is all we need. Okay, so stay with me. What have we done? We've constructed a section of a particular power of this line bundle. The section, the rational section is the Borchardt's product, and its divisor is this single Kudla-Rappaport divisor, Z of P, which is essentially a unitary Shimura variety in one dimension lower. So when you identify the codimension one Chow group with the group of line bundles, then the Kudla-Rappaport divisor Z of P is identified with a very particular power of the line bundle that we're interested in. Now, you apply the cycle class map into cohomology to both sides of this, okay? And then, well, you get the cycle class of the Kudla-Rappaport divisor. When you apply the cycle class map to the power of this line bundle, you get, well, the exponent on the line bundle times the churn class of the line bundle. And in general, the churn class of any line bundle in cohomology, if you want to find a differential form that represents the churn class, what do? You slap a metric on the line bundle and you take its churn form that represents the churn class. And we already have a distinguished metric on our line bundle. And so this Borchardt's product is telling us that in cohomology, the cycle class of this Kudla-Rappaport divisor is this C of zero, which we now know to be an L value, times the churn form of our metrized line bundle. And so if we want to integrate the churn form, well, we're integrating its top exterior power, okay? Well, take one copy, one copy of that, and replace it by the cycle class of the Kudla-Rappaport divisor. And then what does it mean to, you know, wedge a form against a cycle class and integrate? It just means you take the form and you restrict it to the divisor and you integrate over the divisor. But I said that this Kudla-Rappaport divisor is essentially just this Shimura variety in one dimension lower. And that identification was compatible with the formation of these line bundles. So we get the churn form of the line bundle on this lower dimensional Shimura variety. And so we just end up with exactly the same problem that we started with, but in one dimension lower, which by the induction hypothesis is given by this product of L values. And you have to keep track of this C zero and the multiplicity. Remember we had the Kudla-Rappaport divisor was this smaller Shimura variety with some multiplicity. And so you get this expression, which we said was actually just beta of M. And so that's it. By induction, we're done. This integral is just the product of the beta values. And to do the arithmetic volume of this metrized line bundle, you basically do exactly the same argument, but you replace the integral of the churn form with the volume, which I will now do. But I'll pause for questions. Because now I'm going to repeat the same thing, but slightly more complicated. All right, then, here we go. Is that right? Yeah, the arithmetic volume formula is similar. Okay, so now we work in the codimension one arithmetic Chow group. And we have this Borchardt's product. So that's a rational section of this power of our line bundle. And so in the arithmetic Chow group, this power of our line bundle is the arithmetic divisor of the Borchardt's product, which is, well, it's the arithmetic divisor consisting of the usual divisor of the Borchardt's product, which is this Kudla-Rappaport divisor, and then minus the log of the absolute value of the norm of the Borchardt's product. This is a definition. And this Kudla-Rappaport divisor is really just this Shimura variety in one dimension lower with some multiplicity. Okay. So the arithmetic volume, by definition, is you just take this thing, this metrized line bundle, intersect it with itself until you end up with an arithmetic zero cycle, and then take the degree. Well, I take the last copy, and I replace it with the divisor of the Borchardt's product. And I get this 1 over C of 0 out front. OK, for the next step, you have to unpack the definition of arithmetic intersection multiplicity, and you have to unpack the definition of arithmetic degree. But when you do that, you're taking this intersection, you're intersecting it with the divisor of the Borchardt's product, which is really just this unitary Shimura variety in lower dimension, together with some Archimedean component, a green function for that divisor. And so when you do this intersection in degree, you break it breaks apart into two terms, one of which comes from the geometric part of the divisor of the Borchert's product, and the other comes from the Archimedean part of the divisor of the Borchert's product. The geometric part is, well, I mean, here I'm basically putting in an MV prime in place of this divisor. And if I intersect all of these line bundles and then intersect with MV prime, that's the same as just taking all my metrized line bundles, restricting them down to MV prime, and then taking their intersection there, which just splits out the arithmetic volume of the thing in one dimension lower, which we know by the induction hypothesis is some expression in terms of these beta i's. Modulo all of these error terms that I haven't been keeping track of. And then the Archimedean part is, well, the Archimedean part is you take the log norm of the Borchert's product and you integrate it against the top degree of the churn form of our metrized line bundle. And this expression is basically known. So there's a paper of Steve Kudla from, I think, around 1997 called Integrals of Borchert's Forms, where he computes exactly this, but on orthogonal Shimura varieties. But you can repeat the same thing on a unitary Shimura variety. There's no new idea there. Okay, so what I'm doing next, I think I'm gonna skip it actually, is sort of explaining what goes into Kudla's calculation of this. Maybe just the short version of it is that, well, I mean, I'll just tell you his formula. This F, this is our input to the Borchert's construction. You integrate the log of the norm of the Borchert's form for that F against this power of the churn form of our metrized line bundle. And this is what Kudla's formula says. You get the same integral, but without the Borchert's product. And then some expression involving the coefficients of our input form. And then this B prime M S zero, well, B M S zero, these are the coefficients of some Eisenstein series that depends on the Hermitian form. And I'm not gonna go into exactly how the Eisenstein series is constructed, but suffice it to say, it shouldn't surprise you that the coefficients of the Eisenstein series involve L functions. And so this is where the derivatives of our L functions come in. These things are essentially, well, I think it's over here. There it is. When P is a prime congruent to 1 mod D, this is the formula for the coefficient of the Eisenstein series. It involves these beta n's that are supposed to appear in our final formula, and then some correction factors for the prime P and the bad prime, the discriminant of our quadratic imaginary field. And you compute this in the end by computing some local representation densities of a self-dual lattice in our Hermitian space. But their Eisenstein series, you can compute their coefficients. So, okay, we had this formula for the arithmetic volume involving the arithmetic volume in one dimension lower, which we know by the induction hypothesis, this integral of the Borchert's form, which we know from Kudla's formula is related to derivatives of Eisenstein series, which you can compute explicitly and relate them to the beta i's. And so everything on the right-hand side is expressed in terms of values and derivatives of these L functions. And that's the sketch of the proof.
Is this Eisenstein series the one you multiply by to get rid of those poles?
No.
This is a different thing?
It's different, yeah. Because that one didn't depend on the Hermitian space at all. Yeah. These are like the ones that show up in the Ziegle-Vey formula. In fact, I mean, the slide that I skipped, Kudla's proof of this formula, his formula for the integral of the Borchert's form, the key step in that is actually, he uses the Ziegle-Vey formula. Okay, all right, so that was the sketch of the proof. So I have 10 minutes, right? I get 60 minutes to talk. Yes. So I wanna say a few words about what this is for and why we wanted to compute this in the first place. So Brunier and I sort of knew for a long time that one could do this. There's a reason why we finally got around to doing it now. So, okay, these Kudla-Rapoport divisors on our unitary Shimura variety, you can endow them in some natural way with green functions in order to get elements in the codimension one arithmetic Chow group. This is essentially Jan Grenier's thesis. And a theorem that I proved with Grenier, Kudla, Rapoport, and Yang is you take this metrized line bundle that we've computed the arithmetic volume of, and you make it the constant term of just some formal Q expansion whose coefficients are all of these Kudla-Rapoport divisors now endowed with green functions. This is a modular form valued in the arithmetic Chow group, in the sense that if you apply any linear functional at all on the Chow group, coefficient by coefficient, it'll spit out a modular form. So in particular, we've got a natural linear functional on the arithmetic Chow group floating around. Namely, we take our Hermitian line bundle, take almost its top degree intersection, okay, to get in codimension n minus one, and then we can intersect that against the entire generating series term by term. So the constant term is just another copy of that line bundle. So when we apply the linear functional intersect against this, we just end up with the volume as the constant term. And then, okay, these intersections as the remaining terms. This is some modular form by this theorem on the previous slide. What modular form is it? Well, it should be, the constant, its own constant term times some particular linear combination of Eisenstein series, which one hopes to write out explicitly. And in the proof of the volume formula, we were computing more than the arithmetic volume. In the inductive step, we were really computing these things for primes congruent to one mod D. And the same method will let you compute more of these intersections, like at least all primes that split in the quadratic imaginary field. Our hope is that we can compute this, we can compute enough of these coefficients to match it up with some particular Eisenstein series. After all, once you have a guess as to which Eisenstein series you're working with, you know that both sides are modular forms. So if you can match up enough coefficients, like hopefully all primes split in the quadratic imaginary field, you get the remaining coefficients for free, okay? So let's suppose we can do that, then we would get formulas for all of these coefficients, all intersections of Kudla-Rapoport divisors against these powers of Hermitian line bundles. What would you want to do with that? Okay, so this would have applications to the Kudla-Rapoport conjecture. So without going into details, we've got these Kudla-Rapoport divisors on the unitary Shimura variety. But in fact, they construct cycles in all codimensions. So if you take a D by D Hermitian matrix, you can attach a cycle to it. Here we go. Of codimension, the rank of your matrix. So if you take a matrix of non-zero determinant that's D by D, you get something in codimension D. And these cycles can be endowed with green currents, with green forms, to boost them up into the arithmetic Chow group. And if you start with a D by D matrix, you want something in codimension D, but if your matrix is singular, if its determinant is zero, no problem. You just shift the degree by taking this naive cycle and hitting it with enough copies of this distinguished line bundle to shift it into the correct codimension. And that's going to be the corrected arithmetic cycle. Okay, now you take these cycles and you make those the coefficients of some formal generating series whose coefficients are indexed by D Hermitian matrices. And the expectation is that this is also modular. It should be the Q expansion of a Hermitian modular form, some automorphic form on a quasi-split unitary group. So this theorem, this modularity theorem back here, is basically the case D equals one. Higher codimension seems harder. But okay, now take the case where you're in top codimension. Okay, take codimension n so that we're looking at arithmetic zero cycles again. And then in this case, you have the arithmetic degree. And so you can view this generating series as a scalar valued, hopefully, permission modular form. Conjecturally, it's modular. But in this case, Kudler and Rappaport give a much more precise conjecture than just it's modular. They say what modular form it is. It should be the central derivative of a very particular Eisenstein series, the kind that appear in the Ziegel-Wey formula. And this is mostly known by Chao Li and Wei Zhang. If you want to prove that two automorphic forms are equal, well, you can try and match them up coefficient by coefficient. And they prove that the coefficients match for the non-singular terms, determinant non-zero. In other words, full rank, n. Well, what about the singular terms of smaller rank? Like, for example, the constant term corresponding to t equals zero. Well, when t equals zero, remember the definition of this cycle was you sort of take the naive thing and you just hit it with this distinguished metrized line bundle. When t equals zero, that degenerates to you just take the metrized line bundle with itself, intersected a bunch of times. In other words, the constant term of this hopefully automorphic form is the volume that we've computed. And well, we haven't sat down to do this yet, but hopefully it matches up with the Eisenstein series. More generally, suppose T has the form, there's this upper left block where you take some determinant that's plus or minus one and the rest are all zeros. Okay. In this case, the cycle is actually just another unitary Shimura variety of lower dimension. And this cycle class is, well, you correct the cycle in this, this matrix is clearly singular. So you have to correct the dimension by hitting it with a bunch of copies of this. But if this Z hat of T is just this Shimura variety of lower dimension, then when you intersect it with a bunch of copies of this, you're just computing the arithmetic volume of a lower dimensional Shimura variety, which again, one should hopefully be able to match it up with Eisenstein series. So my point is that these volumes that we've computed, they actually secretly appear as some of the coefficients here. And one can try and match them up with coefficients of an Eisenstein series. But you can do even better. For example, let's suppose T has this form. It's really singular. It's just got one non-zero entry here, okay? In that case, this corrected cycle class is, you just take the Kudler-Rappaport divisor defined by M, and then you intersect it with the appropriate power of this metrized line bundle, which again, I'm saying, hopefully we can compute these two back here by matching them up with this GL2 Eisenstein series. And so this was our motivation for doing this, is that Chao and Wei matched up the non-singular coefficients. We have a completely independent method that gets the most singular coefficients. And so our motivation for doing this was, now if you start putting the two together and try to work the problem from both ends, how far can you go? I mean, okay, probably not all coefficients, that's asking for too much, but certainly something. So that's why we started thinking about this in the first place. Okay, so I'll stop there, thank you.
Any questions?
So how important are the precise understanding of the vertical components into the computation?
Yeah, that's a good question. Okay, where do the error terms creep in? It's basically they creep in a lot of places. But back here, when I wrote this proposition, okay? So here there's a distinguished prime P. And here you get everywhere, in every calculation, there are error terms at the primes dividing D. And then here you also get one at the prime P. The primes dividing D, we basically have to compute all of them. I mean, there's no trick to get around them. Here, P was just sort of an arbitrary choice of prime congruent to one mod D. And so you keep track of all the error terms at the primes you're stuck with, the ones dividing the discriminants. At the end, you compute those. So at the end, you only get an error term involving log p, and then you can get rid of the log p error term just by choosing a different prime. So you don't have to keep track of the ones at p, but the ones at the discriminant of the quadratic imaginary field, we pretty much seem to be stuck with. We couldn't find any trick that somehow allows you to avoid computing them. And in these calculations, we needed to know, for example, when you compute the divisor of the Borchardt's product, there's the stuff in the generic fiber that Borchardt's computed, and then all of these correction factors at the bad primes. We needed to know the explicit correction factors at the bad primes in order to do this. Otherwise, everything would be up to error terms and rational multiples of logs of primes dividing D. So the answer is it's important to keep track of them, sadly.
Thanks.
Which is not fun.
Any other questions?
Can I ask a really basic question?
Please.
So I think some slides before, like at the beginning of part three, sketch of the proof, mentioned, you said like there's some subtlety with identifying MV to a modular curve using moduli description.
Yes.
Could you just say that again? I think I didn't understand.
Well, okay. So where did it even go? Back here.
I think it's page 11, yes.
Correct. Okay, so the unitary moduli problem is it's actually kind of subtle. It involves the polarizations. So if you have the unitary Shimura variety parameterizes abelian surfaces with an action of OK and a principal polarization. Mm-hmm. The quaternionic Shimura curve parameterizes abelian surfaces with an action of an order in a maximal order in a quaternion algebra. And then it's a theorem of Drinfeld that the order kind of determines a principal polarization. And so the naive way to try and match these up would be you take the ring of integers OK, you embed it into the maximal order of the quaternion algebra. You now have a forgetful map on moduli, which forgets most of the quaternionic action and remembers just the OK action. And so that gives you a map from the quaternionic one to the unitary one. The problem is this doesn't quite work. And it's because the polarization that Drinfeld constructs is not compatible with the OK action in the sense defining the moduli interpretation of the unitary Shimura variety. And so in order to get the polarizations to match up, you actually have to pass to an isogenous abelian surface. Or in other words, the natural map between them doesn't match up the universal abelian surfaces. It only matches them up to an isogeny. And the isogeny messes up this line bundle that we're working with. It shifts it by certain vertical components that you have to keep track of. And it also screws up the metric. And so you have to keep track of all of these different things. And so the volume that you get on the unitary one, it doesn't agree with the volume computed on the quaternionic Shimura curve because you've changed the line bundle in these subtle ways. And you just have to sit down and work through all of this. It's not deep, but it's. I was surprised that there was actually work to do.
Sorry. So does this kind of issue occur like for higher dimensional cases?
Well, for higher dimensional cases, you don't really have. You only one of these has a moduli. If you do SU, if you do U, n minus one blah, U n minus one one. Uh-huh. Okay, that's SLN, but there's no moduli interpretation. There's no Shimura variety anymore.
Oh, I see.
So it only makes sense when n is two.
I see. Very interesting. Thank you.
Anyone else have any questions? Well, let's thank the speaker for a very interesting talk.
All right, now I get to buy myself a beer.
I'm going to turn off the recording.
Okay.